We will talk about the distinct worlds or regions of the universe. Asian theosophy, as well as the various pseudo-esoteric and pseudo-occult schools, speak about supersensible planes. Unquestionably, the term plane certainly seems a bit confusing, suggesting the wrong idea of a surface upon another surface, like the steps of a ladder. It is precisely due to this assumption why, in our Gnostic nomenclature, we have frankly decided not to use that term. We prefer to speak of regions or superior worlds, located in different dimensions of nature and the cosmos. This way, the knowledge becomes more intelligible, more clear. The three-dimensional, Euclidean physical world is not everything, since above and below it there are other regions of the universe. It is unquestionable that above the tridimensional region of Euclid there are superior dimensions. It is undoubtable that below the tridimensional region are natural infradimensions, properly located within the planetary organism we live upon. If we carefully examine the physical world that surrounds us, we will see multiple phenomena of a mechanical type, namely bioelectric, physiological, metabolic, catalytic, chemical, caloric, etc., which must, unquestionably, have a base, a foundation. It would be quite absurd, for example, to suppose that a living organism, formed exclusively with chemical-physical molecules, has the capacity to speak, think, feel, and act. If that were so, we could then build similar organisms. It could be objected to us, people saying robots do wonders. We do not deny that in any way, but obviously a robot could not, for example, found a school of thought. No robot could write a transcendental, esoteric work. I would like to know a robot that could write a wonderful work like The Secret Doctrine by Helen Petrovna Blavatsky. Thus, robots have action, yes, but limited, robots operate according to their mechanical limits. They cannot act or think for themselves beyond the limits that have been given to them. Thus, so far, we have not even found a Frankenstein that can imitate a human being. It does not exist. All of this invites us to understand, with absolute clarity, that the three-dimensional, Euclidean physical world is not everything. The vital world. Unquestionably, the chemical-physical region needs a nisus formativus, a base upon which it can function. If we examine any organism, we will see that they have the processes of assimilation, elimination, reproduction, perception, sensation, calories, etc. Obviously, this indicates that beyond purely chemical molecules there are structures, bases, that official science does not know. Unquestionably, we know that all chemical-physical phenomena are held by the vital body of planet Earth. It is therefore the vital world, the fourth coordinate, the fourth vertical of the physical world. It is the ethereal world, we say, the tetradimensional zone of this planet in which we live, move, and have our being. Far beyond this vital world there are other regions, but let us first examine well the vital world. Unquestionably, our Earth has a double, an exact duplicate, its principle of life, and this is the vital body. In the human organism, like any other animal organism, there are four modalities of ether. The first modality could perfectly be well named chemical ether, which is related to the processes of assimilation and organic elimination. The second is the ether of life, which is related to the processes of reproduction. The third is the luminous ether, which provides external sensory perceptions as well as calorie development to all organisms. And the reflective ether, the fourth vital principle, relates to imagination and will in all creatures. If we see a flower, we can admire not only the geometric forms and their wonderful petals, but also their color. Undoubtedly, these natural colors are intimately related to the luminous ether of creation. The eye of the eagle is astonishingly sharp. It is well known that from the clouds the eagle can see any bird, any reptile, and immediately rush to hunt it. That is his food, of course, but that eagle's eye is showing us the luminous ether. It would not be possible for there be perception without the luminous ether. We admire the force of will of the great geniuses, and this is related to the reflective ether. Light, heat, color, and sound crystallize throughout creation thanks to the four universal ethers. When the esotericist, with the luminous and reflecting ethers completely absorbed in the astral body, visits those, we might say, Eidetic or paradisiacal areas from the ethereal world, one discovers true marvels, true beauties. In the ethereal world, mountains are transparent like crystal, they are blue, ineffable. We also find the temples of nature there. All creatures of the animal kingdom are organized. The essences, consciousness, that are reincorporated incessantly in the different animal organisms are called elementals. They attend their secret temples, which are located in paradise, that is to say, in the fourth vertical. The elementals of plants, since each plant has its own, are organized in families. For example, one is the family of orange groves, another of the peppermint, another of the pine tree. Each of those vegetable families have temples in the ethereal world. They are instructed there by the devas, angels. Those, elemental, creatures aspire to become human beings someday. In Eden, that is to say, in the ethereal world, in the Garden of Hesperides, as Don Mario Rosso de Luna, the famous Spanish writer said, in the promised land of Moses, where the rivers of pure waters of life pour milk and honey, there are indeed incalculable beauties. One is enraptured when contemplating the gnomes among the rocks, those small creatures mentioned by Philippus Aurelius Theophrastus Bombastus von Hohenheim, Paracelsus. One feels stunned when seeing the salamanders and the flames, those creatures that look like small lizards. They really animate the fire element. One cannot help but be moved when contemplating the playful sylphs of the ethereal world, who give capricious forms to the clouds. One cannot help but be really ecstatic when seeing the nereids of the immense sea, building their palaces at the bottom of the seas. We have been told that when one of them falls in love with a human being, she takes him to her home in the waters, she forms a home with him. It is obvious that the human disincarnates, since he has married a nereid. In the ethereal world we find insignificant creatures, but with an immense power. There are certain animalcules of such regions that it is enough to touch them with the edge of the flaming sword so that a storm can be released, or to stop or conclude a storm. Others have power over erupting volcanoes. The angels of life work in the ethereal world. They have the great mission of endowing a returning, reincarnating, or reincorporating human body with a vital body. Those devas, obviously, have power over the amniotic waters and in general over all matter. The astral world. Beyond the vital world we find the astral world. One becomes astounded when contemplating that region. The astral light is the azoth and the magnesium of ancient alchemists. It is the flying dragon of Medea, the Ionari of the Christians, the tarot of the Bohemians. It is the fire detached from the nimbus of the sun and fixed to earth by the force of gravity and the weight of the atmosphere. One is astonished when contemplating the immense region of the astral world. Theosophists call it Kamaloka. Certainly it has seven regions which theosophists call subplanes. We sincerely state that world has seven tonalities, because, as I said, the terms planes or subplanes have been discarded from our Gnostic lexicon. In the astral world we find two perfectly defined sections, we could call the first superior astral and the other, as the Hindus say, the inferior Kamaloka. In the astral world we find the souls of the dead, the deceased, those who have already left their corporeal covering. There we also find the devas of nature. In the astral world we can invoke the creator gods of the universe and they will come to our call. In the astral world, there are many temples of mysteries. The masters of the universal white fraternity meet in them. We have methods and techniques in order to enter into that world at will. There is nothing that does not have its astral counterpart. Even the planet Earth has its counterpart in the astral world. The mental world. Far beyond the astral world, we have the world of the cosmic mind. Theosophists claim that this region is the Devachan, where after death the disincarnated spend a happy time before reincorporating again. We emphasize the idea that while it is true that the upper part of the mental world is extraordinarily beautiful, not all human beings have access to that higher part. What is normal for them is to return. They reincorporate without having enjoyed the delights of the Devachan. In Devachan, we find many temples where the works of Hermes Trismegistus are described, where his miracles and wonders and great deeds are mentioned, etc. The causal world. Beyond the world of the mind is the causal world. This is how it is called, because that is where the causes and effects are processed incessantly within an eternal now, within an eternal present. The various authors of Eastern Theosophy assert that after death most human beings enter the causal world. That assumption is wrong, because if it is difficult for them to enter into the superior mental world, it is much more so into the causal world. That world is characterized by an intensely deep, extraordinary blue color. The causal body shines beautifully. The mountains there saturated with an ineffable blue. It is a world of causes and effects. There, we see karma in action. There, we see how each cause has its effects, as each effect has its cause, and the process of causes and effects within the eternal instant of life. It is the causal world, a world, we might say, of waves, actions, and consequences. There, the principalities handle karma with great wisdom. The world of intuition. Leaving that region, we would pass into the Buddhic or intuitional world. The Buddhic or intuitional body of the universe is grandiose, sublime. It encompasses the entire solar system and much more. It is named intuitional because there we become powerfully intuitive. It is by means of intuition how one can apprehend, in that region, the transcendental, divine knowledge. The world of Atman. Behind the intuitional body, in its depth, is Atman the ineffable. The world of Atman, obviously, is a world of extraordinary beauty. Nirvana. Beyond the world of Atman, far beyond, we find Nirvana. Nirvana is the region of supreme happiness. In Nirvana, life unfolds free in its movement, within an eternal moment, within an eternal present, within an eternal now. The inhabitants of Nirvana are infinitely blessed. They are beyond good and evil. There are Nirvanis with residues and Nirvanis without residues. What is meant by Nirvanis with residues? By Nirvanis with residues, we mean those whose psyche is still trapped within some egotistical elements. We are not stating that they enter Nirvana with their ego, but that they leave down here in the sensory world elements of their ego, elements that they have not yet dissolved. And what is meant by Nirvanis without residue? They are those who have already dissolved absolutely all undesirable elements. They have nothing subjective within. They have not left in this world any inhuman psychic aggregate. They are, we might say, very well dead. Beyond. But Nirvana is not all that is. Beyond Nirvana is the paranirvanic world, where joy increases in an extraordinary manner, and far beyond the paranirvana is the mahaparanirvana, and finally, we enter into the attic world, and finally, in the monadic. What is the monadic world? It is the world of the third logos, the ineffable and extraordinary region where Shiva, the third logos, lives and beats. Each one of us has a particular, divine Shiva in that region. This is the king that one day must enter here into sensory existence, that one day must be incorporated in its organisms, that one day must be covered with its presence. There are even higher regions, such as those of the cosmic Christ and those of the Father. Well, then, brothers and sisters, what we roughly summarized is described in many volumes of Theosophy, Pseudo-Rosicrucian, etc. We are going to study this, but in a more detailed manner and under the light of the Hebrew Kabbalah. Kabbalah. We have to understand, my dear brothers and sisters, that beyond all of this universal scenario, behind this whole series of worlds that we have roughly described, is the incognizable Sadi before whom all humans and gods prostrate themselves with great humility. If we asked any adept of the white universal fraternity something about himself, he would say, "I am only on the shores of a vast and great sea." The Hebrew Kabbalah speaks of sephirotic emanations, but from where do these emanations emerge? What are these emanations? I have spoken roughly about worlds or regions, only this way knowledge is most understandable, more concrete, more perfect. So from where did these worlds arise, which are nothing but the same Sephiroth? How did they come into existence? They emanated from that, from the Absolute. From the Absolute emanate what? The Sephiroth, which are what we have talked about when citing the various universal regions, so they are the same Sephiroth. This means that the supersensible worlds and the Sephiroth are the same. The Sephiroth emanate from the region of the Absolute. Kether. We have been told that the first Sephira that emanates is Kether, the Ancient of Days, but we must understand what that Elder is, what that great face is. The Hebrew Kabbalah tells us that it is the hidden of the hidden, the mercy of the mercies, the goodness of goodness. Unquestionably Jesus specified it. With a phrase that is Abba, Father. Certainly Kether is our Father who is in secret, and there are as many fathers in heaven as many people on earth, said the great teacher Helena Petrovna Blavatsky. And so it is, each one of us has a Father who is in secret, a Father who is in the heavens, Kether, the Old One of all ages, the Ancient of Days, the Great Face. In him are contained all the other Sephiroth. In the dawn of life only the Elder of Days exists, but from him emanates everything else. From him emanate all the other Sephiroth, worlds or regions, as we have already stated, that come to manifestation. Chokhmah. From Kether emanates, in a second place, Chokhmah, the Christ, but let us not think of Christ as a subject who lived exclusively in the Holy Land, no. Christ is something greater. Christ is a universal and eternal principle that is beyond the I, beyond the personality, far beyond individuality. So the first thing that comes to manifestation, the first thing that comes into existence, we have already said, is the Elder of Days. Kether unfolds himself in Christ, but Christ is not an individual, no. It is a universal principle, yes, and a principle that manifests itself in every human who is properly prepared, but it is necessary for you to know how to understand. We are not trying to undervalue the great Master Yeshua ben Pander, who is Jesus of Nazareth, no. We already know that this great Master is perfect, who was educated, as everyone knows, in Egypt. It is also true that he was initiated into the mysteries of Chaldea, Persia, Greece, and that the best of his esoteric principles were acquired in Tibet, where is still a monastery where he is worshipped, all that we know. When he came to the Holy Land, he was already properly prepared. Nonetheless, the cosmic Christ expressed itself not only through Jesus, but the cosmic Christ also expressed vividly itself in John the Baptist. This is why it was stated that John was a Christus, a Christus. No one is unaware that there were disputes amongst the Gnostics of the Holy Land. Some claimed that Jesus of Nazareth had been only one of those who had resolved to follow John and that the true anointed one was John. The reality is that both John and Jesus had the Christ incarnated. Long ago it was Hermes Trismegistus, the three times great god Ibis of Thoth, who incarnated the Christ. In India, Krishna was the living manifestation of the cosmic Christos. Among the Incas of Peru, Manco Capac was the incarnated cosmic Christ. Here in Mexico we had Quetzalcoatl, the living Christ, manifested in a human being. Thus, the Lord, the Christ, manifests itself wherever there is a properly prepared human. The Christ is a universal principle. It is Vishnu of that sacred land of Hindustan, Osiris of the Egyptians, the sun god of the ancient peoples, the Ahuramazda of Zarathustra, etc. The region of Christ is unity. It is the region of Chakma. In that region we are all one. In Christ diversity is unity. When I wanted to study John, I experienced an extraordinary surprise. When I wanted to study the cosmic Christ, I was also stunned by what I learned. At this moment come to me these unusual memories. One day, when I was in deep meditation, I entered into the state that we could call Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Then I abandoned all vehicles and entered into the world of the Christos, Vishnu, beyond individuality, personality, and the I. I tried to investigate the life of Jesus, the moment of his baptism, and something strange happened to me. To me, who am I, say, a creature as imperfect as any other? The fact is, unheard of, by the way, that I saw myself becoming Jesus and doing miracles and wonders. When I arrived at the Jordan, John was waiting for me. He was clothed in his holy garments as a high priest. I found him at the foundation of the sanctuary. He invited me in and I did so, and near the altar he exclaimed, "Jesus, take off your garments." So I did, leaving my body covered only by a tress tied by a cingulum of chastity. Then, in a fountain, John the Baptist arrived. He took from inside a piece of furniture the sacred oil with which he anoints the initiates, and I was baptized. Then he ordered me to sit on a chair, and then I saw the symbol of the three Logoi, Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva, glittering gloriously in the infinite space. When the Samadhi passed, when I returned again to my human form, I exclaimed, "What? Me, transformed into Jesus? I who am not even worthy to untie the sandals of Master Jesus, not even to wipe the dust off his shoes, and become Jesus? How can this be possible?" Then I said, "I am now going to investigate John. Now it will not be Jesus that I am going to investigate, but John." I went back into ecstasy or meditation again. I left all the vehicles and stayed in the world of Christos. In that region I tried to investigate John the Baptist. In doing so, the picture changed and I no longer saw myself as Jesus of Nazareth, but as John. The same role was represented, but this time in reverse. Then I, John, spoke to Jesus, saying, "Take off your garments, I am going to baptize you." I took the oil from where it was stored and anointed Jesus. When I returned to my physical body after the Samadhi, I understood everything. In the world of Christos there is no personality, no individuality, no I. There we are the One. There we are the Christ. There we are the Buddha. There we are Muhammad. There we are all. If instead of trying to investigate Jesus Christ or John in those regions, I would have tried to investigate any of you who are here listening to me, I would have seen myself becoming any of you, I would have felt like one of you, I would have done what you have done, I would have said what you would say, etc. There is no personality in Chakma, there we are all one. This is why it has been said that variety is unity. Chakma, then, is the world of Christ. Bina. The third emanation is Bina, the Holy Spirit. Some Kabbalists claim that Chakma is male and that Bina is female. That statement is a bit misleading, because Bina certainly can be polarized in male or female form. In the region of Bina we find, then, the third Logos, the particular Shiva of any one of us, our true real being. This is why it has always been stated and said that Shiva is the first begotten of creation. Bina unfolds as the divine mother Kundalini. This is what makes many Kabbalists think that Bina is female. But no, it is male and female. In its masculine form, Bina is Shiva, and in its feminine form Bina is Durga or Kali, the Shakti potential of the universe. And each one of us has a particular Shiva and Shakti or special, individual divine mother. Thus, brothers and sisters, the three superior Sephiroth are the very beloved Father, the very beloved Son, and the very strong, very wise Holy Spirit. Much is discussed in relation to the qualities of each of them. Experience has taught me that the Father is wisdom, that the Son is love, and that there is power in the Holy Spirit, without, of course, also discarding sapience. These three supremes form the great Sephirotic crown, but everything comes from the Ancient of Days, from the Father who is in secret. Obviously, these three superior regions constitute the Kabbalistic Absolute, the world of splendors, where happiness is extraordinary, beyond good and evil. Chesed. From that Sephirotic crown emanates, manifests, becomes, in its turn, Chesed, which is Atman, the innermost, the region of Atman, the ineffable. In that region there is an incalculable joy. Atman is the innermost in us. The ancient testament of learning said, before the false dawn came over this earth, those who survived the hurricane and the storm gave praise to the innermost, and to them appeared the heralds of the dawn. M. The dayspring of youth. The innermost is almighty. In Chesed, the world of Atman, one knows the stark reality of the world. Here, in this physical world, Maketh, we see, for example, the altar on which those books are placed. In Yesed, the ethereal world, we can find the counterpart of that altar. In Hod, the astral world, we still see that altar, even there it glows a little more, but there it is. In Netzach, the mental world, we can even know the content of those books. In Tifereth, the causal, we go further, we can know the psychic part of those books. In Gebura, the Buddhist or intuitional world, we see the altar and the books, and yes, instantly, by intuition we know its deep significance. Yet, in Chesed, the world of Atman, all is reduced to numbers, to mathematics. There we know how many atoms that altar has, there we will know the atoms of wisdom that typify each of the words that are written in those books, and finally, everything in Chesed is reduced to numbers. Therefore, the world of Atman is a world of a stark reality. When one has not yet entered the world of Atman and all of a sudden one experiences it for the very first time, one then feels as if entering into a strange, vague, divine world, something one cannot describe, something like I do not know what. What indeed happens the first time one consciously enters in that region is that one is overwhelmed, because one finds a world of the most shocking reality. In Chesed, one finds not only, we might say, this temple as we see it here, but we also know exactly how many atoms are in this temple. And not only that, but their atomic quality. Chesed synthesizes everything in mathematics. It is, therefore, a world of overwhelming reality. When we move ourselves in the atmic vehicle and we enter the kitchen of a house, we would not only see the food, but we would also know exactly how many atoms are within each dish, what vitamins, what principles, what a degree of consciousness each molecule has, what elementals relate to it and what development they have, etc. Gebura. A sunderable major part of Atman is found in the Buddhic or intuitional world. For us males, it is a great joy to find there, for example, our Valkyrie, the Shulamite of Solomon, the feminine divine soul, the beautiful Helen of Troy. Likewise, it is a great joy for females to find there, their most beloved, their Solomon, their eternal bridegroom. So it is in the Buddhic or intuitional world where we find our true consort. This is a region of extraordinary splendors. The Kabbalists say that Geburah, Hebrew, severity, power, is severity, and that severity is governed by Mars, while the planet Jupiter, the father of the gods, has always been associated with Atman, Chesed. This is what the intellectual Kabbalists state, but I know that Atman is governed by the warrior, Mars, because Atman has to fight for his liberation. As far as Budi, Geburah, is concerned, they have always wanted to associate it with Mars. A certain Kabbalist, whose name I do not mention, complained about Geburah, that when she tried to concentrate and meditate on Geburah Mars, she did not succeed. She triumphed when trying to concentrate on Yesod, but not on Geburah Mars. Indeed, how could she have triumphed? Impossible, right? Do you not see that she concentrated on Mars Geburah, and that is absurd? Because the region of Geburah is the Buddhic or intuitional world, where we males have our Valkyrie and females their beloved one, thus Geburah is not ruled by Mars, but by the Sun. So, when Kabbalists have not directly experienced the Sephiroth, then these Kabbalists rely on purely intellectual matters and fail. The cold scheme is not enough. Direct, cognizant experimentation is needed. I am talking to you based on my experience. In the Sephira Geburah, although it is true that the Lion of the Law exists, it is no less true that we find mercy, love. With just reason Solomon sang, in the Song of Songs, to his beautiful Shulamite. It is the Buddhic or intuitional world where we truly feel the unity of life, where we experience communion, we might say, with the whole solar system of Ors. Tifereth. By continuing with the sequence, sundrance, Geburah turns asunder into Tifereth. Tifereth is nothing else but the causal world, a world where everything flows and reflows, ascends and descends, grows and decreases. In this region there is a systole and a diastole, the systole and the universal diastole, and all the systoles and diastoles of this great universe. In the causal world the principalities work intensely, there we see the archons of the law. It is a world, I repeat, where the causes and effects are joined within an eternal now, within an eternal present. It has been said, quite clearly, that the human soul, Tifereth, is completely Christic, and that it is in Tifereth where we come to eliminate even the last elements of the I. That is right, because there we finish with the very causes of the ego, of the myself, of the self-willed. Where else could we end up with those causes that originated the different eyes that we have inside? Obviously, in the world of natural causes, in Tifereth. The human soul there, in those regions, loves and is loved. The human soul has to marry its consort in the Buddhic or intuitional world. Tifereth is, we might say, the savior. If we apprehend the superior Sephirotic triad, the great crown of Kether, Chakma, and Bina, we have in synthesis the unique, indivisible, integral, father. The second triangle is the triangle of Atman Budi Manas, or to speak in a more Kabbalistic manner, Chesed, Geburah and Tifereth, who becomes the Son within us. This is why when Philip asked Jesus, show us the Father, then the great Master replied, who hath seen me, the Son, hath seen the Father. John 14. And so it is. When I was working intensively in the world of Tifereth and once I completed a special esoteric work, Chakma entered into me and as a human soul I felt transformed. Who would not feel transformed when the Christos enters into us? But it is intriguing that precisely in Tifereth, in the world of the Savior, was where I could evidence that reality. The first triangle has always been called the Sephirotic crown or the Logoic triangle, while the second triangle is always called the triangle of the Sun or the triangle of ethics, because it is that we know what is good and what is evil. Then comes the third triangle, the triangle of magic. Tifereth turns asunder into Netzach, which is the world of the mind, and this also turns asunder into Hod, Netzach. There is about everything within the universal mind, because although it is true that in the lower mind we see the counterpart or the mental form, we might say, of all of this sinful and perverse civilization, it is no less true that in the upper part of the mental world, the devotion of Asian theosophy, we find the pure mind. Yet, one has to do a great work in the depths of Netzach. In the world of the mind, we must remove from our mind every unworthy particle, every inhuman element, every perversity. With good reason, Helen Petrovna Blavatsky, in her great work titled The Voice of the Silence, exclaims, "Thou hast to reach that fixity of mind in which no breeze, however strong, can waft an earthly thought within. Thus purified, the shrine must of all action, sound, or earthly light be void, e'en as the butterfly, o'ertaken by the frost, falls lifeless at the threshold, so must all earthly thoughts fall dead before the fane, temple, voice of the silence. Ere the golden flame can burn with steady light, the lamp must stand well guarded in a spot free from all wind." Bhagavad Gita. Therefore, you will be able to comprehend. How could the fire of the spirit shine within us if the mind is filled with cosmic dust? Therefore, it is urgent and imperative to purify our mind. In the world of Netzach, we understand how much we have to work in order to truly reach enlightenment. Netzach, Hebrew, victory, is called the world of victory. Why? Because to achieve victory, one has to triumph and free oneself from the mind. And to achieve it, that is the most difficult task. On the secret path, the one who has worked in the august mysteries that lie hidden in the Ark of All Ages is warned hundreds of times by the side of the road, "So far you have arrived here well, but now that you are going to work with the mind, remember that all those who have tried it have failed. Rare are those who have not failed, because the mind is really perverse, dangerous. You are listening to me in this room, you have come to listen to me, and I am here to tell you great truths. But this is a serious thing. Are you sure that tomorrow you will be here with us? You yourselves have witnessed that many who came before now no longer come. Some even plead for entrance to third chamber, and entrance was given to them, then later they do not return anymore. Such is the mind. Now you will explain to yourselves why the final liberation is difficult. You will also be able to understand at this moment the reason why the world of Netzach is called victory, the region of victory, because indeed, if we succeed in conquering the mind, we have triumphed. Whosoever achieves liberation from the mind is a victorious one, a Buddha. In the world of the mind there is an extraordinary temple. There we see the counterpart of the deep seas and the continents. With the mental body we can travel throughout the solar system, and even far beyond. We can travel there. In that vehicle the melodies of the devotion resonate miraculously, like a harp of wonders in the infinite space. The temples of Hermes, with their gates of glory, shine among the fire of the whole universe. This is where we can discover all the great works that Master has done. Hod. Netzach turns asunder into the world of Hod of the Kabbalists, the astral world. Obviously, the lower region of Hod is the lower Kamaloka of which Hindus speak. In the upper region we find many Mahatmas, many splendorous and happy angels. In the lower section we can find all the witches' sabbaths of the Middle Ages, all the temples of black magic, the grieving souls, the suffering creatures, all those who moan and cry, and also all of the perverse ones. Yesod. A further part asunder and shows us Yesod, the ethereal world, where the deposit of the universal sexual forces is found. This cubic stone of Yesod is sex. Unquestionably, the region of Yesod is, as we have already stated, the ethereal world. Thus, Netzach, Hod, and Yesod constitute the triangle of magic, priesthood, Maketh. We are here, in the physical world, in this fallen Sapphira, in Mocketh. Here is where we are, studying, preparing, working, but Mocketh is not just the physical world. Remember that in the interior of the earth, in the infra dimensions, are the Klippoth, and these are from Mocketh. Klippoth. There are 9 inferior dimensions, wisely symbolized by Dante in his Divine Comedy. In those 9 infra-dimensions, human beings devolve. Because of their exaggerated perversity, many enter into the kingdom of Klippoth before they have completed their cycle of physical manifestations, but there are others who enter the kingdom of Klippoth because their manifestation time has expired. We have been told, and it is true, that each one of us is assigned 108 physical existences. Thus, if within them we have not reached realization, once the cycle of manifestations is performed or fulfilled, we descend into the world of Klippoth, even if we are not evil or perverse. I know someone there, whose name I will not mention, who still lives on the face of the earth, whose eyes still perceive the soft light of the day. He is a good son, and he studies medicine. His parents love him. Recently he had a traffic accident, he was hit by a car, and it was then that it occurred to me to investigate him in the regions of the invisible world. Certainly, I found him, and in the name of the truth I say, not in the upper zones of the three-dimensional world, no, but in the world of Klippoth, in its first sphere that we might call sublunar, in the first Dantesk circle. How could this be? Some might ask, if he still lives? Indeed, it is true, but he exhausted his 108 existences, and although he is a good son, a good citizen, his cycle of manifestations has concluded, and since he did not do anything for his self-realization in any of his past existences, the wheel rotated, the wheel of samsara, and now he devolves within the submerged mineral kingdom. I know another person, a lady. She still lives on the face of the earth, but already dwells in the third Dantesk circle. Obviously, she abused the creative energy of the third logos and went downwardly through the black path. When she disincarnates, she will continue her life in that region, in the third Dantesk circle. There is another one that is in the fifth Dantesk circle, that one has already disincarnated. There are creatures so perverse that upon leaving the body they immediately enter the ninth Dantesk circle. What would we say about those extortionists, those murderers who kidnap people and then collect their ransom and even murder them, as we read in the news that the press has given us and that continues to give us, in all of the countries of the world? Monsters of that class are unquestionably candidates for the ninth Dantesk circle. So, is it possible that through successive births, as emphasized by both members of the various pseudo-esoteric and pseudo-occult institutions, creatures could evolve to the final liberation? Obviously not. Because it is demonstrated, and facts are showing us, that instead of evolving we have devolved. If you take a look at the current panorama of humanity, you can evidence this fact in those millions of beings that populate the face of the earth. Are these crowds pure and beautiful? Are these the innocents from ancient Arcadia? Are these people those who worshipped the sun and the spirits of the dawn, in times when our earth was beautiful in all its splendors? Do you think that those who live now could enter Eden? Where are the perfections of all those millions of beings? We have not found them, have we? And is that evolution? Indeed, that is really devolution. I do not know what the fans of the dogma of evolution base themselves upon in order to assert, to assure, that everything is progressing. Behold, the human being has lost everything. The human senses have degenerated. The humanoids have become monstrous, horrible. If we were to be in those times when the rivers of pure water of life flowed with milk and honey, those would be the moments when the lyre of Orpheus resonated throughout the universe. Sadly, these are not those moments in which we were worshipping the holy gods. In the streets, we see people who appear to be very innocent, like those in the Garden of Eden. How innocent, are they not? They walk together holding hands, how sweet! With an innocent appearance, but if we go and see the bottom of that, behold what fornications, what perversities! So this how the world is, here, there, and everywhere. Therefore, the dogma of evolution is false. To assure that all of us are evolving towards becoming gods is a lie, because the facts are showing us the contrary. Where at this moment are the pyramids with their great mysteries? Indeed, they are there, in Teotihuacan, dead and cold. Where are the pyramids of Egypt with their hierophants? There they are, those sun-baked, stone boulders, bearing the weight of the centuries. But their hierophants, what happened to them? Now they walking around, wandering, fallen, wallowing in the mud of the earth. In past days I made a precious investigation that left me perplexed. We have talked a lot about the Apostle James, the blessed master of the great work. The universal epistle of the great apostle is there, still standing, but there was something that left me perplexed. I went to the world of cosmic consciousness, and in that region of the Sapphira Hod, I wanted to know something. I discovered that in one of his previous existences he had been nothing less than one of those famous Huiracocas. So, behold, how different, right? The James of the Holy Land appeared in Spain, and much later in another part of the planet. He was an immortal, that is obvious. If everything had been left there, there would be nothing to become surprised about. The grave thing of this matter is not in that, but that he fell, and also lost the immortality of his vehicle. But, to fall, the blessed master of the great work to fall? Impossible, we might say, but indeed he fell, and now he lives at this moment in Brazil. He is within our Gnostic movement, and is working for humanity. He is struggling, indeed, to redeem himself again. But lo and behold, immortals also fall. In general, my dear brothers and sisters, everything in these times is profound darkness, fallen angels, desecrated sanctuaries, defeated initiates, pain, bitterness. Could it be said that this is evolution? No, it is not. If even the great ones have fallen, what would we say about those who have never reached the level of hierophants or something of the sort? What would we say about all those crowds, all the modeled set of people who come and go through all of these streets of God? They fulfill their destiny, karma, they finish their cycle of manifestations, and thereafter they go down into the worlds of the Klippoth for their own good and for the good of others. But what fortune would await us if the lost ones did not descend into the world of Klippoth? Imagine for yourselves, if there were no higher principle, if there was no force in nature to disintegrate the I, the myself, if the ego were allowed to grow, where would the ego reach? Fortunately, the wheel spins incessantly. When one has not yet realized the self, one descends into the bowels of the earth for our own good, because ultimately what the divine wants is good for us. It is true that when we descend to such regions we suffer, it is true, but after we pass through the second death, we emerge forth pure, innocent, and beautiful, and enter paradise, yes, the elemental paradises of the world of Yesid, in the ethereal world, in order to initiate a new journey as simple elementals, as gnomes of the mineral kingdom. What beautiful paradises those regions of nature are! How beautiful it is to enter, we might say, into the paradises of the vegetable world, where there are inconceivable beauties. And then to continue from plants into animal beings, and finally to reconquer the humanoid state, a pure, innocent state, with marvelous possibilities. So, although there is pain in those Klippothic regions, this is in order to liberate us, it is for our own good. The divine mercy is great, and all evil, no matter how great it is, has its punishment, but every punishment, in turn, has its limit. That is, no one will pay more than is owed. No matter how serious the crime, the punishment has a limit. Thus, this humanity, although it has been perverse, will undoubtedly be punished, yet with a limit, it will disintegrate through the second death within the bowels of the earth, and at last, the free essences will continue in new, grandiose, harmonious, evolving processes. We must understand all of this, my dear brothers and sisters. We have to make ourselves cognizant of what the Sephiroth are, of what evolution is, and of what devolution is in the world of Klippoth. Whosoever truly tries to pass beyond all these evolving and devolving processes of the Sephiroth must walk the path of the middle, the Eightfold Path, the narrow path that leads to final liberation, because the Sephiroth have evolution and devolution. In the beginning, these emanations are within the Logos, within the Ancient of Days. In the world of Absoluth, the Logos handles everything directly, but when the Logos turns asunder in all those Sephiroth, when all of these Sephiroth emanate from the Elder, everything changes, they fall into the world of manifestation until falling into the physical world. The four worlds. But what is to be understood, or what is the world of Absoluth? The world of Absoluth is the world of the splendors, the world of the Sephirotic crown, the world of great happiness. What is the world of Bria? It is the world of the spirit. The refined Atman Buddhimanas of Eastern Theosophy, namely, Chesed, Geburah and Tifereth of the Hebrew Kabbalah. What is the world of Yetzirah? In Yetzirah we find the mental world and the astral world. And finally we find the world of Isaiah, which is this physical world with its submerged regions or the abodes of Klippoth. So these four worlds, Absoluth, Bria, Yetzirah and Isaiah, are intelligently processed. What is the greatest world? It is, I repeat, the world of Absoluth. In the beginning all these emanations are within the Ancient of Days, and the goodness of goodness, from him all Sephiroth become. The Logos directly handles all the Sephiroth, I repeat, directly, because already in the next world, in the world of Bria, he manifests himself through the divine hierarchies, likewise in the world of Yetzirah, as well as in the world of Isaiah, which is this physical world, he manifests through the chakras of the planet Earth, through the zodiacal signs, the planets of the solar system, and even through the tattvas or vibrations. He can only act directly, without intermediaries, we might say, in the world of Atman, Chesed. It is intriguing to know that Maketh, this physical world in which we live, which is of fallen Sephira, was, one day, precisely within the Ancient of Days. Maketh became from him as an emanation until taking the form that it has in these moments. This is wonderful, thus, finally, the day will come when Maketh will undergo successive transformations until returning again into its source of origin, into Kether, the region or the Ancient of Days. Thus, the ten Sephiroth involve and evolve. However, the most interesting of the Sephiroth are not their involutions nor their evolutions, but their revolutions. One can make the revolution of the Sephiroth in oneself, here and now, by treading the path of the razor's edge, the path that leads us to the inner self-realization of our being. Do not forget, to that end, that the inner realization of the being becomes something extraordinary and is achieved through the great union of Shiva and Shakti, that is to say, through the union of our Father who is in secret with of our Divine Mother in the cubic stone of Yesod. I am addressing now the Sephira Dath, which is nothing but tantric knowledge. We need to handle that tantric knowledge, we need to realize that knowledge within us, because it is through tantra how we will achieve the ascension of the sacred fire through up our dorsal spine. It is through the tantric knowledge, that is, through the Sephira Dath, how we can one day return transformed into the Ancient of Days, to become an Ancient of Days ourselves. In one word, we need to integrate the ten Sephiroth within ourselves, here and now. The Sephiroth are within us, but we must integrate them in order to become gods. When that is achieved, we will have the right to knock at the 11th door, but before knocking at that door, we must have the 10 Sephiroth absolutely integrated within ourselves. Thus, already integrated and perfect, we can knock at that door of wonders and it will open. Within it is the Ein Sof, or the third aspect of the Great Absolute. Following these cosmic developments, we can knock one day on the 12th door, which is the Ein Sof, and finally, blessed be the one who knocks at the 13th door, the door of the Ein, because that one will become a Satguru, that is, a living manifestation of the Absolute, here and now, that one will become a Sadhi beyond good and evil. Remember, my dear brothers and sisters, that the number 13 is holy. Jesus and his 12 disciples formed 13 people, a group of 13 people. 13 were also that council of elders who ruled the holy land of Anahuac. The Aztec calendar is based on the 13. We have been told in the secret doctrine of Anahuac that there are 13 heavens, and this invites us to reflect. There are 13 worlds that are combined with the 13 Sephiroth, because the Ancient of Days, the goodness of goodness, Kether, the 10th of the Sephiroth, is not everything. He becomes from a superior Sephira, who is the 11th, Ein Sof, or, and the 11th in turn becomes from the 12th, Ein Sof, and the 12th from the 13th, Ein. In the beginning, everything is within the Logos, within the Ancient of Days. In the world of Absoluth, the Logos handles everything directly, but when the Logos turns asunder in all those Sephiroth, when all of these Sephiroth emanate, everything changes, they fall into the world of manifestation until finally reaching, falling into the physical world. Thus, there are 13 heavens, 13 worlds. Our solar system has 13 planets, let us enumerate them. Earth, Mercury, Venus, Sunday Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, Pluto, Vulcan, Persephone, Clarion. These 13 planets typify the 13 Sephiroth that make up the 13 heavens of the Nahuatl wisdom. So, therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, if we want to become gods, it is vital to self-actualize all the Sephiroth of the Kabbalah within ourselves. The entire doctrine that we are teaching here leads to that. So far for now tonight, this is the conclusion of our lecture. However, I am willing to answer the questions that the brothers and sisters would like to ask in relation to this topic. If there is anything to ask, you may ask. Questions and answers. Disciple, during your explanation, Venerable Master, I remembered a talk from a fellow who named himself Swami in the United States. Would you like to explain the origin of that word Swami in relation to the theme of the Sephiroth? Master, well, unquestionably, my dear brother, many Sanskrit terms have been greatly abused. The term Swami, for example, is very demanding. Swan, Chon or Yon is very sacred. The Swan Chon or Swami is the third Logos. The meaning of the swan in itself is the one who has resurrected in himself. When the swan, the phoenix, resurrects from its own ashes, when our king rises from the sepulchre of crystal and comes here to the world to see with the eyes of the flesh and to touch physical things, that is undoubtedly a Swami, but to accommodate that title so capriciously just because, and to use it as is used by so many in Hindustan and even in the Western world, is a blasphemy, a profanation, an insult to the third Logos. The same thing happens with terms like Satguru. It is understood by Satguru someone who already struck, sat, and entered Hall 13, that is to say, the most authentic manifestation of the Absolute in a human body, a god, like Jesus of Nazareth, a Paramartha Satya. That someone, it does not matter who, I do not emphasize a particular person, because it is not right to name anyone, by mere whim is called Satguru? That is a crime, because none of us is worthy to wipe even the dust of shoes from a Satguru. Compared to a Satguru, we are nothing more than worms in the mud of the earth. Nonetheless, in these times of worldly crisis and bankruptcy of all moral principles, these most sacred names are desecrated. That is right. Is there any other question, my dear brothers and sisters? Disciple, the Father unfolds into the Divine Mother, but according to your explanation, Bina, the third Logos, also emanates from himself his divine spouse. Then I do not understand, Master. Master, this is a very abstract point with which many students have become entangled in all times, in all ages. To comprehend the Trimurtis, Trinities, is super difficult for the mind, and only on the basis of a lot of intuition and direct mystical experience can they truly be understood. There are several Trimurtis. For example, the Trimurti of the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit, or in Sanskrit terms, Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva, that Trimurti, and all Trimurtis are the same Trimurti yet different. It takes a lot of intuition and lots of direct experience so that one does not get confused. Undoubtedly, the first Trimurti relates to the first triangle, the logoic triangle. The ethical triangle is the second triangle, and the magical triangle is the third triangle. The logoic triangle, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, is indivisible, unitary, integral. There is no need to subdivide it greatly. The Trimurti Father, Son and Holy Spirit in general is named Father, and I pointed out, Father, and that is it. That Father, if we say so, deep down we are not lying, we are telling a great truth, unfolds himself into the feminine, Shakti, and from these two, the outcome is the Son, the Divine Spirit, Christ, of every human that comes into the world. That Divine Spirit is the Son of the Shakti, she conceives the Son by the work and grace of her spouse, the third Logos. Now, when we come to incarnate that Divine Spirit in us, totally, when the Son is born completely in us, we then will understand the Trimurtis. I do not know where the difficulty is. I do not see, then, what confusion can be, if it is clear. The issue is not to divide or subdivide so much into the first triangle, because Father, Son and Holy Spirit are one whole, unitotal, and in general it is named Father. The second triangle is called the ethical triangle, with a focal point that has been studied by all Kabbalists, which is nothing less than the Sephiroth Tifereth, the human soul, the Savior, the Christ in us. And the third triangle is the magical triangle, formed by Netzach, Hod, and Yesod. Netzach is the mind, Hod the astral, and Yesod, sex. This triangle has its basic center of gravity in Yesod, the cubic stone, sex. Thus, in that stone, is where Shiva and Shakti are. They are united in the region of sex, in the ninth sphere, and from that union results Didh, tantric knowledge, through which it is possible for us to raise the sacred fire upwardly through the spine in order to become a master. And, Maketh is a fallen Sephira, which we already know. It is the physical world. So then, if we call the logoic triangle Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, if we name each of the aspects of that superior logoic triangle, we may do so, but it is not right for us to schematize it too much, because at last and in the end, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit are integral, unitotal. The first triangle is indivisible and is generally said to be the Father. That its third Sephira, Bina, unfolds in the Shakti potential? It is true. She is his wife, but her husband is Bina with Chakma and Kether. The three of them together are the same Father, the spouse of the Divine Mother. Is there any other question? You may ask, brother. Disciple, do the souls of those who still live in this three-dimensional region but who are already in the infernal worlds, when they die, go to the first circle and then descend to the next, or do they go directly to the fifth, or ninth, or any other? Master, well, one enters directly into the region with which one is more affine. I know a certain lady whose name I will not mention who is good-hearted but has already fulfilled her 108 existences and is now, in the first region, in the sublunar region, the first infradimension or first dantesque circle. She naturally likes the things of this physical world and certainly identifies herself with that circle, since in it one lives a life very similar to that which is here in this physical world. I know of another very different case, of someone who is too angry, who has the tendency to fight at all hours, who has made money his religion and who does not long for any spiritual principle. This is currently in the fifth submartian or inframartian region, in the fifth dantesque circle. So, there are others that are so perverse that they immediately enter the ninth circle, they are the perverse. I did not get to specify that detail in my book Hell, Devil, and Karma, but in a second edition of that book, I will expand that detail, which is quite important. Well, are there any other questions? Disciple, Master, the perverse are in the ninth dantesque circle, but since it is there where the ego becomes cosmic dust, do the eyes of each of these souls also descend from sphere to sphere, just like the eyes of the other lost souls? Master, well, according to the law of gravitation of the worlds, we know that everything descends to the center of gravity, as something that falls towards the very center of the earth. Therefore, if someone, for example, entered the first dantesque circle, that one will gradually go down from sphere to sphere until reaching the ninth, and it is in the ninth circle that one becomes cosmic dust, where one passes through the second death of which the Book of Revelation of St. John speaks. Unquestionably, in the eighth circle, the most serious processes of destruction of the ego have already begun. In this there is an astonishing miracle. We have been told that the devil has a tail. Well, this must be understood. The abominable Kundebuffer organ is indeed the fire precipitated from the coccyx into the atomic hells of any human, but when we analyze that type of fohat we discover something that astonishes us, which is that the Divine Mother in the underworld becomes polarized negatively.
That is frightening!
She is manifested in the famous tale of the demons and in the eighth circle. See the Divine Comedy. There you will find documentation. That serpent that forms the tail of the demon swallows up the lost entity. She gives herself a banquet. She devours it in order to destroy the ego, in order to turn it to dust, and she completely destroys it in the ninth circle. In that sphere, the processes of total destruction are happening. And why does she destroy them totally? She does it so that the essence, let us say, her child, can leave hell. This is the shape that she takes in order to save her creatures. Any other question? Disciple, if the perverse go directly into the ninth circle, would that imply less permanence or less time within the infernos than the time of other lost souls who begin their submerged devolution on the first circle?
Master, well, the mind is cunning. Those are games of the mind.
Indubitably, it would appear to be that way if not for the law.
That is, that the perverse in the ninth circle would be quickly disintegrated and that's it, they get out fast.
That would be as if someone who committed a terrible crime went to jail and immediately got back out.
It would be something like that, but the law is the law.
It so happens that those very vicious individuals of the ninth circle, who, once having entered the ninth circle, will have to remain there until all of their karma has been paid, because all of that is directed by the judges of the law. At random, they are in charge of applying the corresponding punishment to each one. So there is no need to wrap your brains around this.
Any other question?
Disciple, is there any possibility that any of these absolutely perverse entities, even in the ninth circle, could be revolutionized?
Master, the phrase absolutely perverse is quite serious, is not it?
Undoubtedly, if we speak of absolute in a relative manner, yes. Yet, there are people so perverse that they do not even have an atom of free essence, that is obvious.
But that the wicked can be revolutionized?
No, they cannot, because it turns out that the stronger one is in evil, the weaker one is within the earth. There, one devolves, or rather, there one goes in reverse. There, progress is the other way around.
For example, in the submerged regions, as a man descends more and more, he becomes weaker and weaker, and when he reaches the 13th initiation, he passes through the second death, ceases to be a demon, and the essence becomes free. Let us not forget that in the abyss, truth is disguised as darkness. If it is true that in the upper worlds there are initiations of the universal white fraternity, likewise it is also true that in the infernal worlds there are initiations of the black fraternity. The one who reaches, for example, the 13th initiation in the bowels of the earth, disintegrates, becomes dust. As that one falls, that one becomes weaker and weaker. Moreover, he does not want to progress. Learn more. Share this page.